For 4 weeks now, I've been using the DJI Pocket 2 before I felt it was right to do a review. Packed into this tiny little body, believe it or not, there is a more than capable 4K camera, a sound recorder, and a 3-axis gimbal. The question is it really any good? And more importantly, is it worth the money? Pocket 2 is a definite improvement over the original Osmo Pocket, primarily by a larger sensor, a faster lens, and exponentially better sound recording, as well as some small improvements. Now the question you may ask yourself is, with so many glowing reviews on YouTube, is can this tiny little camera actually compete in any way with larger full-frame cameras with interchangeable lenses? Well, yes and no. It all depends on what you use it for and what your expectations are. In all fairness, it would be totally unfair to compare the Pocket 2 against larger DSLR cameras. I know that some of you might want to know whether this is the perfect little camera that can do it all. Well, the answer is yes, sort of, but with limitations. But if you're wondering whether it can get anywhere close to the depth of field and features that you get from larger cameras and lenses, well, to be frank, nowhere near close. That's just the way it is. It's not me saying it, it's the laws of physics. When a single lens can be as big as this whole setup, you're bound to get better results. Now saying that, the Pocket 2 does stand out in other areas. Don't be fooled by its small size. This camera gimbal can literally punch above its weight. And I can say, having used it for a number of weeks, that overall, it's a fantastic camera gimbal. So far, after 4 weeks using it in all sorts of environments and situations, the results I get out of it is nothing but brilliant. With a sensor that is 1/1/7 inch in size and a whopping 64 megapixels, the footage you get is sharp, smooth, and honestly, from the moment you turn this thing on, you can tell how good this gimbal is. I mean, once it's all set up, you just can't go wrong. The larger sensor means that you not only get better image, but also higher dynamic range, higher frame rates, and an overall better performance. One thing that has definitely been improved from the original Osmo Pocket is the sound recording. And this is something that I'm really happy with because there is nothing more irritating than watching something with bad sound. A lot of people complain about this in the original Pocket camera, and it seems that DJI was listening because, you know, they've done their homework. The Pocket 2 has now 4 stereo mics in the body itself, one on each face of the gimbal. What that means is that right off the bat, you actually get a pretty decent sound. And not only that, but to make things even better, you also get the option to select which of the mics you want active or turn off. The front alone, front and back, or all 4 mics on. Those settings alone get you quite a lot of control over the audio that gets recorded. If, for instance, you select the front and back mics and you turn off the side mics, well, you can genuinely get rid of a lot of unwanted sound around you. It won't be perfect, but definitely far better than the average onboard camera mic. That's guaranteed. Now, in terms of audio levels, you do get the option to set the audio to auto or manual, and to my surprise, the auto settings are actually quite good. You need to understand though that in this size, you're never going to get a professional set of tools for sound recording. That's just unrealistic. On the other hand, what you get is actually pretty decent. And if you get a creative combo, which I highly recommend, you get a wireless mic thrown in that has an average range of around 20 to 25 meters. And that, in my opinion, is a game changer because the sound quality that you get out of it is actually pretty good. Much better than I ever expected, to be honest. So now the audio that you're getting is the onboard the stereo microphones on the DJI Osmo Pocket 2 itself. And as you can see, the quality is okay, you could use it. But let's just switch over now and see the quality when I turn the wireless microphone on. And it's as simple as turning, flicking a switch. The DJI Osmo recognizes automatically the wireless microphone, and this is the audio I'm getting from the wireless radio mic that you get with the Creative Combo. Now, I highly recommend that you get the Creative Combo with the do-it-all handle. Trust me on this, it's well worth the money you pay for. You get a wide-angle lens that takes you from the standard 20mm to a 50mm, a wireless mic, remote on-off switch, a wireless sound receiver built into the handle itself, and this little tiny tripod which, you know, some might feel that is completely useless. I get the feeling that people will find creative ways to make use of it because, you know, if anything, at least it gives you somewhere to rest the gimbal on. Personally, I always use a proper tripod to mount my cameras on. But for extreme low angles, I have to say this tiny tripod can actually be useful. But if you're in a controlled environment doing any low angle filming, I would highly recommend using a micro slider so that you can get those nice, slow and smooth tracking shots. Given the tiny size of the Pocket 2, I think it's a fantastic tool to get shots that would otherwise be very hard to get. Going back to the creative combo, the wide angle lens alone is worth the money you pay for the whole thing. It's sharp and with no distortion around the edges. That is basically what you want from a wide angle lens. Honestly, I've lost count of how many times I've got a wide angle lens to find out that it has horrible edge distortion issues. So it's nice to know that you don't need to worry about any of that nonsense anymore. The only drawback though, which is a rather big one in my opinion, is that you cannot put any filters on the wide angle lens. So the actual use is somewhat limited. That is, if you care about using NDs or any other filters. On the other hand, if all you want is to run the gimbal on auto and let it do its thing, then the wide-angle lens is brilliant. Personally, I think ND filters are an essential accessory if you want to stay within the 180 degree rule and get the best results out of the camera. If vlogging with this camera is what you're looking for, there is a relatively inexpensive hack that you can do to turn the standard 20mm lens, which some people might feel is a little bit too tight, into a much wider field of view. Simply get yourself a monopod, and all you need to do is outreach, and automatically you get a much wider field of view. Now, what this gives you is the ability to use ND filters with the gimbal instead of using the wide angle lens that you limited at not using the ND filters. Now, if you are self-aware about talking in public, this may make you look a little bit odd, you know, having a monopod reaching out. So you'll have to either get used to or use the wide angle lens and compromise your image quality. It's a decision that is entirely up to you, but the difference is quite noticeable. If you use the camera front facing, well, this trick is not going to work. So you're back to having to decide whether you want to compromise on image quality by using the wide angle lens and probably a very high shutter speed to compensate for the brightness levels, or ditching the wide angle lens altogether and going with the standard 20mm, which, you know, gives you the ability to use ND filters, which depending on what you're filming and the time of day is probably what I would do myself. What I'm trying to say here is that there is a clear and obvious difference between filming with the camera on auto compared to manual with ND filters on. If you set the camera to auto and let it control the shutter speed to compensate for the brightness levels, you'll end up getting very sharp and choppy footage. By comparison, your footage will look really nice and smooth if you use ND filters to compensate for the brightness levels and keep the shutter speed at double your frame rate.
I'm going to demonstrate in this busy roundabout the difference of using an ND filter and not using an ND filter, and see how much sharper and unnatural the images look with no ND filter and how much smooth and natural the images with ND filters look. So I'm going to pop an ND filter now on, and let's see which one you reckon looks much more natural. Pay attention to the motion blur of cars and even people, and hopefully you can see the difference. Let's talk active tracking. It's a feature that has been theoretically improved in the Pocket 2, but personally I don't recommend anyone using. You launch it by simply dragging a square on the subject that you want to track, and from that moment on, the gimbal does track the whatever, in this case my face. The problem is that it leaves a lot of headroom at the top, and also the gimbal is moving quite aggressively sometimes left and right, and it's very distracting. Personally, I set the gimbal to follow, and from that moment on, you are actually using the gimbal. All you need to do is just get familiar and learn how to use the gimbal. But the movements will be a lot smoother, and the gimbal will follow you wherever you point it to. But you don't have to worry about not able to control where the camera is pointing, whether it leaves too much headroom or whether it turns too aggressively. You are in control of the gimbal. Whereas if you have the gimbal set to active tracking, you're not in control of the gimbal. Entirely up to you. Myself, I prefer to be in control of things. One bit of advice that I would give anyone wanting to use one of these gimbals is that instead of holding it upright in a 90 degree angle, simply tilt it slightly to a 45 degree angle. It will help getting rid of that walking motion that you see up and down. Another tip is that instead of holding it upright on your chest height, just bring it down to your belly area. You'll be lowering your center of gravity, and that will also help getting rid of that up and down motion when you walk.
One thing that works like a charm though is the autofocus. DJI has done a really good job here. You do get the option to set the camera to either auto or manual focus, which in a camera this tiny, it's quite impressive. If you want manual focus, just select AFS from the drop-down menu and whatever you single tap on the screen, the camera will focus on. To be honest with you, this is more geared towards still images or in video if the subject is fairly still. But for anything to do with movement and given the fact that the camera doesn't have a very shallow depth of field, I personally recommend you stick to autofocus by setting the camera to AFC. You'll thank me for this. Trust me, if you use the gimbal on its own, the screen is tiny. And trying to work out where the focus is, well, good luck with it. This is why I prefer the Mimo app, because when you attach your phone, you can see a lot more. Technically, you could do manual focus, but the truth is that if you tap the screen, that movement will translate into vibrations. So unless you have someone else controlling the rig wirelessly through the Mimo app, and based on my use of the camera for 4 weeks, I would stick to autofocus and be done with it. Don't get me wrong, I love its tiny size and I can see myself using it in situations where space is an issue or if I need to be somewhat concealed. But the screen is too small and I just find it hard to keep on top of composition and movement while playing with the menus and settings. I much prefer attaching a mobile phone and having a large screen where I can see what it is that I'm doing. Now, if there is one thing that I recommend anyone that gets this camera gimbal is to turn on the Pro mode over the Standard. Standard mode means pretty much everything is in auto. And that, unless you are someone with no interest whatsoever in learning about how to use a camera properly, is not what I would want. With the Pro mode on, you get manual control over things like exposure, white balance, shutter speed, color profiles, focus, sound. Well, this is where things get interesting. I find that in general terms, with the Pro mode on, you do get a fair bit of control over the gimbal and camera settings. It's far from perfect or ideal, but way better than going auto all the way. Look, using the Pocket 2 on its own can be a bit irritating as you have to swipe left and right, up and down to make changes to the settings. Honestly, its biggest selling point, which is its size, can also be its downside. Because as much as I love the small size, the screen can feel way too small at times, and there is no way around it. With the phone attached to the Mimo app, it's quite easy to navigate the menus as it's all there on one screen. Making changes is really quick and intuitive, and it goes without saying that having a larger screen means that you can actually see what it is that you're doing. There is a slight lagging, but it's not too bad. And even when connected wirelessly, which is a feature that I absolutely love, the lagging is really not that bad either. One other very cool feature that you get is what DJI calls mic input focus. And I think this is really clever. What it is that if you zoom in, let's say at yourself talking in the distance, the mics will somewhat zoom along and the sound will focus on you rather than capturing the audio where the camera is.
Well, let's see how well it works. So theoretically now the sound should be cleaner where I am and you should be disregarding the audio from where the gimbal is. Personally, I think it's a little bit pointless. Get yourself the Creative Combo, comes with a wireless mic, and it's as simple
as flicking a switch, and then you get all the quality audio that you need without having to worry about fancy gimmicky features that may or may not be useful. One cool feature that is genuinely useful is, I don't know if you notice what I'm doing, I'm controlling the gimbal remotely from my mobile. And that is a cool feature. I get access to all the settings, I can control the gimbal, I can set it up to whatever I want, all the settings, I can change the exposure, the ISO, and that genuinely is a cool feature. It's ideal, for instance, if you have someone else operating the gimbal or with time lapses, where touching the camera can be a bit of a problem. This is a feature that some high-end cameras don't have, so if you think about it, it's quite impressive. In terms of the user interface, DJI has done a good job both on the Pocket 2 on its own and also in the Mimo app. There will always be room for improvement, but as it is, I can't see anything that stands out like a sore thumb. Changing the resolution, frame rate and other settings is really easy and straightforward, regardless of whether you use the gimbal on its own or through the Mimo app. One thing that I have been very impressed with is the fact that you can manually set the shutter speed while having the ISO in auto. Not only that, but you can actually set the low and high rating for the ISO. I think this is really helpful because the camera then adjusts automatically within those set parameters, and you don't need to worry about massive swings in exposure, which basically makes the footage unusable. Something that I also noticed is that the auto adjustments of ISO, although in real time, they are actually quite smooth. So if you're likely to be in a situation where brightness might change through the shot, this is a very cool feature. I discovered this while filming at night and it's definitely very helpful. Other cool feature that I think is worth mentioning, for instance, is higher frame rates. You can now shoot 4K up to 60 frames per second, and in this tiny body, I think it's remarkable. But what is really amazing is that you can also do 120 and up to 240 frames per second at 1080p, and that is insane. A slow-mo in this camera looks brilliant, but you need to be aware that you need a lot of light for 240 frames per second. So daytime, outdoors, you will probably be fine. But if you want to do a slow-mo indoors, you will need a lot of light, and not just any light, but flicker-free. I've done commercial slow-mo shoots before, and I know for a fact that large tungsten lights over 5K are the best for high-speed filming. But to be honest with you, 5K tungsten lights are not small lights. They get super hot as well. I've been in high-speed shoots with tungsten lights where you actually get a tan. They get that hot. So in my opinion, a slow-mo is for outdoors only. I just can't see the sort of people that will buy the Pocket 2 going all out using a studio light or renting a studio for that matter. One thing that is brilliant is how fast the boot-up time is. I mean, it literally is ready to go in less than 2 seconds. Now let's think about this for a second. In just 2 seconds, you have a perfectly balanced 4K camera on a 3-axis gimbal. You're not gonna get that in any other camera equipment. And that is what makes the Pocket 2 interesting. If you're someone who wants to vlog, but is not comfortable waving a large camera in public places while talking to it, well, this is perfect for you because you will literally go unnoticed. If anyone sees you holding this camera, they'll probably never imagine it's a camera in the first place, let alone that it's pointing at you. This thing is really that small. Sticking to the main features, you also get 2x zooming video and 4x zooming photography mode, which can be useful, but you need to be aware that it's digital zoom, it's not analog. Myself, I'd rather avoid it if possible. But it's there for when it's needed, and I always say that it's better to have it and not need it than to need it and not having it. The gimbal can be switched between follow, tilt-locked, and FPV modes, each one of them giving you different functionality. You can use FPV for doing cool things like spin rolls. Tilt-locked, well, the name is self-explanatory. It locks the tilt, so the gimbal will never tilt, whatever you do. Follow mode is my favorite, and as the title says, it follows your movements in a very natural way. You can choose between fast and slow, and frankly, for the most part, slow is the way to go. One aspect of the camera that is worth mentioning is that with a larger sensor, you also get a faster f1.8 lens compared to the f2 in the original Osmo Pocket. This naturally means better low light recording, and also when using ND filters, a shallower depth of field, or blurred background as some people might call it. But don't get too excited. If shallow depth of field is what you're after, you'll be disappointed. You get some of it, yeah, if you bring the objects close to the camera, but if you're after a 50mm film equivalent depth of field, well, forget it, it ain't gonna happen. Back to what I said earlier, it's not me saying this, it's the laws of physics. A tiny sensor means hardly any depth of field. That's just the way it is. But in my opinion, this camera gimbal is not there to compete or go head to head against larger cameras. It can do things that other cameras can't do, and that is what I think you should focus on.
If filming or taking photos for social media is what you're after, it's as simple as turning the gimbal on its side and you're ready to go. Easy, simple, that's what the Pocket 2 is all about. But the question that many want to know is, with the increased resolution compared to the original Osmo Pocket and higher frame rates, is this any good in low light? So this is how the camera performs in low light. Personally, I think it's fantastic. You can see a lot. And taking into consideration the size of the camera, I think it's phenomenal. But you know, let's take the gimbal for a spin and see what images we can get. Photography is not something I would get the Pocket 2 for, but in all fairness, at 64 megapixels, results are quite impressive. Personally, I would never choose it over a decent DSLR camera, but the feature is there, and if you know what you do, the results are quite impressive. Anything to do with landscapes, establishing shots, or any shots where everything has to be in focus, the results are fantastic. Helpful, definitely in a pinch, but nothing that resembles professional photography. You just have to have that clear. But if you know what you do, with 64 megapixels in resolution, the results are really impressive. If there is one thing that I love about the Pocket 2, is time-lapse and hyperlapse. Honestly, this is where I think the gimbal performs at its best, and the results are fantastic. And because this is a gimbal, you can set your time-lapse with keyframes and have the camera starting at one point and ending on another. And not only two keyframes, but four. You also get some default options like right to left and left to right, which in many situations might just be all you need. But if what you want is a time-lapse with those cool night light trails, you will need ND filters, and there is no way around it. There is absolutely no way you can set the exposure to, let's say, 2 or 3 seconds and compensate for that level of brightness by reducing your shutter speed. Forget it. If you do that, you will get the correct exposure, but you'll get every single object looking sharp and crystal clear. To achieve those cool light trails, you need NDs. And I would say anything between 16 and 32, possibly even 64, depending on your settings and how bright or dark the environment that you are in is.
So who is this for? In my opinion, if you're into real estate or similar, where what it's important is to have everything in focus, it's a no-brainer. This is an amazing camera gimbal. It will save you time and money. It's also brilliant for vlogging, traveling vlogs, trips and holidays, and even B-roll or even C-roll. I mean, the possibilities are there for pretty much any use. Just don't expect it to have shallow depth of field. This is not a full-frame camera, so as long as that is clear from the outset, you'll be fine. It may as well be all you need to take with you when traveling for those holiday videos, and avoid having to carry heavy camera equipment with you and pay for those extra charges at the airport. I hope you find this review helpful. If you like it, give it a thumbs up. Subscribe to the channel and help us grow and keep doing videos on a regular basis, and we'll see you in the next video.